Well, thank you very much for that introduction, and Kathy, for having me here today. I think you know, my mom used to work in the advertising business years ago. I'm not sure if anybody here goes back as far as Marvin and Leonard, an old ad agency on Newbury Street, where she worked there. So she'd be very proud that I'm here today talking to the ad club. And I was, you know, the last ad club event, I'm embarrassed to say the last event I came to was actually at, I think it's the Microsoft building where you used to have events. So when I walked in here, I was reminded, and I see Adam here, the last time we were here, we were, you know, we don't feel very smart when we come to this building. We were actually here to see a robot that was being built to throw batting practice to David Ortiz at Fenway that was going to be controlled by a Google Hangout with people around the world controlling what type of pitch was thrown to David. So it reminded me that we need to resurrect that conversation and hopefully make that happen, because we don't have that many more days left with David. So I thought what I'd do, just to let you know kind of what I'm gonna what we'll do today, you know, provide you some information about Fenway Sports Management, which is part of the Fenway Sports Group portfolio of companies. Give you a little background information on us, what we do, talk a little bit about our relationship with LeBron, because I think a lot of people, when they hear LeBron James and Fenway, they kind of look at us like we have three heads. And then talk also about a relationship that we have with one of the great brands in Boston, New Balance. And then finish up, and I want to leave plenty of time for questions, and we have a great bag of swag, Red Sox swag, and Liverpool swag. For any good questions, you'll get a nice little prize. So with that, I thought the first thing I'd do is show you a brief video that kind of gives you a look inside the window of FSM, and then we'll get going.
High fly ball right center field. Beresnik back to the triangle. Long run. He won't get it. And the Red Sox walk off with the win. How do you like that?
So we got a lot going on in our world, as you can see there. So just to give you a little overview of how we sort of fit into Fenway Sports Group. So FSG is our parent company. It's the holding company that John Henry and Tom Werner are the principal partners of, that purchased the Red Sox and Nesson and Fenway Park back in 2001, as you can see here. And then Fenway Sports Management was created in 2004, and the genesis of FSM was really to diversify and to look at opportunities to generate revenue in sports that would not be subject to the revenue sharing system in Major League Baseball. For those of you that follow baseball, you know, it's a bit of a socialist society, and the fact that the large market teams support the small market teams. So it's kind of frustrating when you know, when you're playing Tampa Bay like we did last night, to know that a lot of the money that we generate is actually going to help pay for Tampa Bay's players. But so we created FSM to really leverage a lot of the relationships that we had established through the Red Sox and leverage the Red Sox brand to get into some different business lines of business, and I'll talk about those in a second. In 2006, we purchased a 50% interest in what was then Roush Racing, which is one of the leading, winningest motorsports organizations in the world that races in the NASCAR series, and have been involved in an ownership capacity with Roush. And then most recently in 2010, as you heard from Alan, we purchased Liverpool Football Club. It was kind of an interesting the story behind us purchasing Liverpool. At the time, there was a gentleman in our office who was a passionate Liverpool fan, who has followed the team religiously, as most of their supporters do, and the team had fallen on some financial problems, and it was almost in receivership, and suggested to our ownership group to take a look at it, which they did. And when we looked at Liverpool, we saw a lot of the same things. I should not me, but John Henry and Tom Werner and company saw a lot of the same things that they saw when they were thinking about buying the Red Sox back in 2001. A tremendous brand with a huge base of fans, in this case around the world, literally around the world, hundreds of millions of fans around the world. They played in a historic venue, Anfield, which is very similar in that respect to Fenway Park, and an opportunity to really build the club into something special. And we've been at it now for 6 years, and I think that we learned a lot with Liverpool. We're really starting to turn the corner now, and we're hopeful we're off to a 2-1 start. We won last night, and hopeful that things are going to, you know, really pick up, because it's, as I say, unlike the Red Sox, where our fans are really regional or national, Liverpool's fans are at all corners of the world. We go to Australia, and we'll have 90,000 people show up at a match. It's really incredible. So a little bit about Fenway Sports Management. Our business is really broken up into three areas. We spend the most of our time selling. We sell sponsorships for a number of different properties. We obviously, as an owner of the properties that I just outlined, we work very closely with each of those organizations to sell sponsorships. So when you go to Fenway Park and you see the Dunkin' Donuts sign or Bank of America or New Balance, any of the brands that you see, we're involved in putting those deals together. And I'll talk a little bit about one of those deals in a few minutes. We work very closely with Nessen, which is our sister company, in putting together advertising deals as well. Roush Racing selling sponsorships for the cars and for the drivers, and obviously Liverpool Football Club as well. But in addition to that, we're also licensed by a number of properties to represent them. We don't have an ownership interest in these properties, but we have a license to work closely with them. So you saw in the video some footage from Boston College. We've been, I think, for the past 10 years maybe, the sales and marketing agent for Boston College Athletics. Work very closely with the folks over at the athletic department there, putting deals together. We've been working with the Deutsche Bank Championship, which is coming up here in Boston in a couple of weeks, to do the same thing. We're also the sales representative for Major League Baseball Advanced Media. In baseball, BAM, as it's known, controls all of the interactive media rights. So if you actually want to buy a ad on Yankees.com or on Dodgers.com, we're involved in that process. And the last logo that you see there is that of LeBron James. We invested in LeBron back in 2010. I'll talk a little bit about that as well in a couple of minutes. And then lastly, we're an owner of some minor league baseball teams. These are the Pawtucket Red Sox, the AAA team down in Rhode Island, and the Salem Red Sox, which plays in the Carolina League based in Virginia. We have an ownership interest in those clubs and are involved in helping them as well drive revenue. So that's in our sales and representation world, these are the properties that we work with. We also have a consulting and events group. Our consulting groups works with brands to put together, to leverage sports to help them achieve their business objectives. This is, you guys have probably seen this, year two of a campaign that Duncan has run with David Ortiz and Rob Gronkowski. We work very closely, obviously, with Duncan and with their digital agency, Sapient, and Hill Holiday as well, in putting this campaign together. And we do similar work for a variety of other brands as well. And what's been interesting as it relates to this business is a lot of the companies that we work with have a larger relationship and with Fenway Sports Group. Duncan, for example, is a big advertiser, a big sponsor with the Red Sox. We do a lot of work with JetBlue as well, who's a big sponsor. Stop and Shop, to name a few. And then the third piece of our business is our special events business, and you saw some imagery of that in the video. This really started back in 2003, when we had our first concert at Fenway Park, which was a Bruce Springsteen concert. But what we've really done in connection with a lot of the improvements that have taken place at Fenway over the years is we've really looked to make Fenway Park a year-round entertainment destination. So this is obviously a picture of Frozen Fenway. We're about to have our fourth version of Frozen Fenway coming up here in January, which is going to be very exciting. As an owner of Liverpool Football Club, we obviously bring the Liverpool to Fenway Park as part of their North American summer tour that they do every couple of years, which has been a lot of fun. I think this picture was taken last year. And in fact, I'm looking at that picture. I think that's Billy Hogan, our chief commercial officer's son, that's walking out as the mascot with Scrotum. Am I right? That's Billy's son. It's good to be Billy. Our concerts, I don't want to take the credit. Our concerts are a partnership that we have with Live Nation. We work very closely with Don Law and his team. As I mentioned, back in 2003, our first concert with Bruce Springsteen was we had one concert that year. This year, we have 11 concerts at Fenway Park. We just finished our third stage setup and breakdown, and we've got one more to go when Jason Aldean and Kid Rock come to Fenway Park in a couple of weeks. And it's a great partnership that we enjoy with Live Nation. What's been really interesting this year, because we have so many concerts, and this is where we do get involved, is we've actually branded all of the concerts at Fenway Park, the Fenway Concert Series, and our sales team has gone out and has and sold that sponsorship, as you can see there, from Plain Ridge Park Casino and to Prime Motor Group. So this is a lot of fun. Hopefully most of you have had the opportunity to take in a concert at Fenway. It's a great take. Last year was a very busy year for us in November. We really, November's a great month for us to look at doing special events because we're through the baseball season. Hopefully, playoffs, run through the end of October. So November's a great month before the snow starts to fly. Last year, we had a couple of big events. This is a photo taken from the Irish Hurling Classic that we had, which was amazingly successful. I think it exceeded all of our expectations. Again, it gave us an opportunity to go to a new partner, AIG, to get them involved in the Fenway family, to become part of the Fenway family of sponsors. We're going to be bringing this back in all likelihood next year. And then we had the Notre Dame-Boston College football game, the Shamrock Series, which took place last November as well. And then lastly, this image always, this is a pretty amazing image. This was the Big Air event that we had at Fenway Park back in February this past winter. I think that ramp, there's a guy in our, he's not here today, Fred Olson. I think he's still recovering from this event, having been the guy that orchestrated the construction of this 150-foot tall ski jump that was placed smack dab in the middle of Fenway Park. So it was a lot of fun. What's great about these events for us is, and I mentioned it with AIG, it really gives us an opportunity to market the events to new corporate sponsors. So you can see here, Polar Tech was the title sponsor of this event. It was a hugely successful event for us and for them. Matt Lauer, the Today Show, they had a live shot from the top of the ramp. And Matt Lauer was talking about Polar Tech during that live shot. And we have a great relationship with this company that we never would have really had a relationship with if it wasn't for this. And I'm sure we'll be doing a lot of things with them in the future. So these events, we've really, as I say, we'd like to think that we're a year-round. Fenway Park is now a year-round entertainment destination. And we're always looking for new and innovative things that we can bring to the ballpark that sort of fit into that overall strategy. So I talked a little bit about LeBron, and as I said, a lot of people kind of look at us crazy when how does LeBron kind of fit in? And it's kind of an interesting story about how this deal came together. When LeBron, shortly after LeBron decided to leave Cleveland and go to Miami, the team of people that he had around him felt that it was it would be a good idea to sort of expand their inner circle and partner up with some people that could provide more reach, international reach, and market LeBron to a broad audience. It was there's a gentleman named Maverick Carter who is LeBron's close friend and his business partner, And managing the business of LeBron was a full-time job. Managing his Nike relationship is a full-time job, candidly. And Maverick and LeBron wanted to expand their family, if you will. And so we had the opportunity to sit down and pitch Fenway Sports Management as the agency to do that work for him. And you know, we weren't and we're not in the athlete representation business. And when we sat down with LeBron to present ourselves, we actually said that. We want to represent you because we're not in the business of representing athletes. We're in the business of representing blue chip brands. And we put a logo up on a screen similar to the one that you saw earlier on in the presentation with the Fenway Sports Group logo, the Red Sox, Liverpool, Roush, and then a picture of LeBron. And he got it just like that. And there was a, beyond working with LeBron and the benefits that come from that, there was really a strategic reason why we pursued the relationship. LeBron is massively popular in China. I've had the good fortune of traveling over there with him on a few different occasions, and you would not believe what it's like when he goes to do an appearance. I was just at a Nike town in Shanghai. He had an appearance inside the Nike town. He was doing some interviews, and there were 20,000 people literally outside the Nike store just hoping to get a glance of him as he walked into the store. And as we think about Liverpool and the growth of Liverpool, and you've probably been reading a lot about Chinese investment in international soccer, Asia is the next big frontier for European football clubs. And we felt that having LeBron on our team, if you will, would be advantageous for us as we look to make hay in Asia and in China specifically. So as part of our relationship with LeBron, we actually gave him a small financial interest in Liverpool, which really did two things. It motivated him to help us promote Liverpool on an internationally, and it also satisfied his thirst for his entrepreneurial spirit and his interest in owning things and his, you know, where he's going with his business now. It's less about the traditional sponsorship deals and more about owning things, and I'll talk about that in just a second. So as part of our deal with LeBron, we do traditional endorsement deals, and this is one example. Kia came out with a luxury car a couple of years ago called the K900. And we got LeBron involved with that. You know, we did a deal for LeBron in China with Dunkin' Donuts. I know I think Scott Hudler was here for the last CMO breakfast. And Dunkin' at the time was looking to plant a flag in China and build their business there. And because we have a great relationship with Dunkin' at the highest levels of the organization, we were able to present LeBron as a resource to them to really look bigger, candidly look bigger than they really are in China right now, as a way to attract development partners and as a way to introduce the brand. This is a photo that was taken at an event that we had in Beijing, where LeBron was doing some work for Dunkin' and its sister company, Baskin Robbins. So there are a number of deals like that LeBron does, some of these traditional deals. But to speak to the, you know, some of the other benefits that we've realized through a relationship with LeBron, these are a couple of interesting images. The one on the left is a photo that was taken of him. We took him during the last, when the NBA had its last work stoppage. I'm not going to remember exactly what the year was. It might have been prior to the 2012-13 season. We took LeBron over to Anfield for a Manchester United match, which was a great experience for him and, you know, great for us as well. The picture on the right was taken following a playoff game. We had given LeBron some Liverpool swag to wear during his post-game press conferences. These post-game press conferences get seen globally around the world. And he put that, there were a few different times that he did this. He put that jacket on during the press conference, and within hours, the phone was ringing off the hook at our team store. They couldn't keep the inventory in stock long enough. So it really speaks to the power of LeBron and how these are great examples of how he has helped us with Liverpool as we look to build the business of that organization. Anybody know what this is? Pardon me? It's Justin Timberlake and Jay-Z performing at Fenway Park. And you might wonder, what does that have to do with anything here? LeBron helped us with this. He has a wonderful relationship with Jay-Z. When they were making their decisions on touring and coming to New England and the Boston area, they had a lot of options to choose from. And we were able to, through the help of LeBron, we were able to, you know, get them to look at playing at Fenway Park, where they played for two shows that sold out, which had a tremendous benefit for us. That was a great show, by the way. I don't think I'd have walk-up music from Jay-Z. That wouldn't be my walk-up music. Just another interesting example. This is a photo that was taken from a LeBron does a lot of work for Samsung, and this is a photo that was just a screenshot that was taken from a TV spot that he did for him did for Samsung several years ago, and that relationship evolved into a relationship with the Red Sox through we were able to build a great relationship at the time with the chief marketing officer from Samsung. It started with LeBron, and believe it or not, it led to this. You guys may remember this photo that was rather controversial, but Samsung at the time was, I think you may remember from the Academy Awards, they did something, I think it was with Ellen DeGeneres, and they were big into the selfie. And this photo was taken after, in April of 2014, after we had won the World Series, when the Red Sox were doing a White House visit, and Samsung hired Ortiz. They did a deal with the Red Sox. They wanted David to sort of capture the experience of being on the White House lawn, and ultimately he had the phone when he was out on the field during the ring ceremony. We didn't think in a million years that he'd pull this camera out of his pocket and take a picture with the president, which became a scandal internationally. But I will say, if there's one deal that I want to be remembered for, this is it, because I never in a million years would have thought that something that our team was involved in would wind up as a skit on Saturday Night Live. So take a look.
Last week, Red Sox slugger David Ortiz was criticized for taking a selfie with President Obama using a Samsung phone because Ortiz has an endorsement deal with Samsung. Here to comment is Big Papi himself, David Ortiz. What's up, Big Papi? So how was your trip to the White House?
Oh, it was good, man. We have a big lunch.
You get a big lunch.
Oh, yeah, we have empanadas, tostones, bistec and coco, shrimp mofongo, arroz con leche, y chicharrón con jamón.
You had all that at the White House.
That's what I say, man. Big Dominican lunch with Big Papi.
Now, Big Papi, I do have to ask, did you intentionally take the photo as a promotion with Samsung?
I don't know, it's a problem, man. It's a problem? I don't know. I talk to Sam's son, I talk to Sam, they tell me it's no problem.
Sorry, Sam's son?
Yeah, it's like commercial that I do. Sam's son. You like Sam? You should meet his son. With Sam's son. He's the son of Sam.
No, see, I think it's pronounced Sam's son.
Oh, no. There's a difference.
Oh.
I do ask for that too. Same song. Giant ass phones. Is that a television or a phone? Same song, Galaxy. If it can't fit into my pants, that's a problem.
Now, Big Bobby, can I ask how much money you got from Samsung?
Oh, they give me 100,000.
Wow.
Chickens.
Wow, okay.
Do you know what you can make? With 100,000 chickens, yos, you can make mofongo. You can make arroz con pollo. Pollo guisado. Guasacaca con queso frito.
So I take it you're really into chickens.
Oh, claro que sí. That's why I also do ask for Chick-fil-A. Chick-fil-A. Come eat a Chick-fil-A. Unless you yay. I'm sorry, no way. It's their slogan, it's not me.
That's their slogan.
It's their slogan, that's not
their
me.
Slogan. Yeah.
Dominicano, baby, yeah. All right.
Now, do you have any other endorsement deals, Big Papi?
Oh, yeah, I also do commercial for home security. Bass for bass. You got bass in your house? Hit them with a bat. It's bass for bass. Or how about this one? Do you suffer from depression? Don't.
What's that an ad for?
For not to be sad. Why you be sad? Don't.
Well, I have to say, it seems like President Obama's pretty upset that you used him for a promotion.
Oh, no, 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 don't worry. Big Papi make it up to him. Big Papi sent him a big basket of food. I sent him a fungo. Yuca fritas. Chimichurris. And of course, cerveza from the Dominican Republic. Presidente. Presidente. The beer that no Presidente has ever drunk. Hey, Papi. Hey, come on, man. Let's take a picture real quick. Okay. Yours.
That's a phone?
Yeah, it's
That's
my
a
phone.
Giant phone.
Let's say a Big Papi.
A Big Papi. David Ortiz, everyone.
Domingo,
good stuff. That actually, they've had a couple of other skits with him that have not about Samsung, but that came from this, which is very funny. Just a couple other quick things on LeBron. Some other ways that that he and we have benefited. I'm not sure if any of you have seen the show that he executive produces, Survivor's Remorse. But through the relationship, our relationship with LeBron, and ultimately his relationship with our one of our owners, Tom Werner, who is a Hollywood producer. They created this show that's now in its third season on Stars. It just started its third season. So it's really helped, again, LeBron. He's started his own production company, and this has been kind of at the front edge of that. But as it relates to what we do in selling partnerships with LeBron, if you watch this show, it's no surprise that the lead character, one of the main characters in the show, Reggie, drives a Kia K900. So it gives us an opportunity for product placement. You'll probably see Beats headphones. You'll see Samsung products, things of that nature that are integrated into the show. And then lastly, LeBron, and we're an owner in this company, started Uninterrupted shortly after he published his essay in Sports Illustrated around his return to Cleveland. You know, he talked about how he did it in an uninterrupted fashion, meaning he wasn't quizzed by the media and interrupted by the media when he did that. And so that was the genesis of creating Uninterrupted, which is a digital network that allows athletes to kind of tell their own stories. So if you go on to Bleacher Report, you can see more about Uninterrupted. They're going to be doing a lot of interesting things in the future. So the relationship with LeBron, which at the time people were wondering why we were getting into it, has come back to us tenfold, and as we look to the future, we're partners with him for many more years. There's a lot of, I'm sure there are going to be a lot of really interesting things that are going to come down the pipeline. So just to move on quickly, because I know we're going to be short on time here, I wanted to talk a little bit about our relationship with New Balance, as I referenced earlier, which is a great New England brand, Boston brand. I had the good fortune of working with them years ago when I was with the Celtics. The Davis family are wonderful people. And believe it or not, this sort of speaks to how things come together. It's kind of interesting. Believe it or not, our consulting relationship with Dunkin' Donuts is what ultimately opened the door for us to have a conversation with New Balance about a partnership with Fenway Sports Group. This is just a photo that was taken. We had hired Dustin Pedroia to do a campaign for Dunkin' Donuts, and we were down at spring training shooting the commercial, and Dustin comes walking out of the clubhouse in his uniform for the shot, and he's got on a pair of New Balance baseball spikes. And I'm, kind of keep, being in the business, sort of keep an eye on things like that, what athletes are wearing. And I had no knowledge of the fact that New Balance was in baseball. And in fact, they weren't technically in baseball yet. They had done a deal with Dustin to put New Balance product on New Balance baseball spikes on his feet when he played. And I talked to Dustin, I said, tell me a little bit more about it. Long story short, it led to a conversation with the folks over at New Balance, which then led to a relationship with the Red Sox. This is one of the manifestations of that relationship, a great sign that they have over the bleachers in right field. And we started a wonderful relationship with New Balance that has been in existence now for 6 or 7 years. When we bought Liverpool in 2010, it was interesting. It was at a time when our kit deal with Adidas was coming up for renewal. The kit sponsor is the manufacturer, the company that actually makes the uniform, not the logo that's on the front of the jersey. So the Pumas, the Nikes, the Adidas's, the Under Armours of the world. And the Adidas deal was coming up for renewal. And we were literally about to, the previous ownership group was about to just sign on the dotted line and extend the deal with Adidas. And we said, well, hold on a second, let us create a market for that. Let us go out and talk to some of the other brands that might be interested in something like this. And the first phone call that we made was to New Balance to see if it was something that they'd be interested in. They had, we sat down, we had a meeting with Jim Davis and his executive team and said, this is an opportunity that's available. And wouldn't you know it, that they were, at that time, thinking about what they could do to bring their brand, to bring their, there was at the time the Warrior brand, which is a sub-brand of New Balance. They were looking to go global, and they were trying to figure out how to do that. And long story short, it led to a kit deal with Liverpool, which at the time was the largest kit deal in the history of European football. Subsequent, 2 years ago, they switched from the Warrior brand to the New Balance brand. This is a photo, actually, that was taken a few weeks ago at Facebook's world headquarters out in the West Coast, where we, for the first time any team has done it, I think, Keith, you can probably validate that, we unveiled, this is the third kit, so there's a home kit, a road kit. This is the third kit that the team wears periodically. They unveiled the kit on during a Facebook Live event that 300,000 people watched this event at Facebook, which led to the more sales of the kit coming out of the gates than Liverpool or New Balance had seen in previous years. So it's a great example of a relationship that started with Dustin Pedroia walking out of the clubhouse with a pair of New Balance spikes. New Balance now is Fenway Sports Group's largest business partner, largely due to this investment that they make with Liverpool. The last thing I want to talk about, some of our colleagues from the Globe are here, is the Globies. This sort of falls into our events business. As many of you probably know, John Henry purchased the Globe several years ago. When he did that, we started thinking about ways that we could work collaboratively with the Globe in a number of different areas to help drive circulation, to help ad sales. And one of the manifestations of that was the creation of this event, which is basically we sort of marketed it as, or call it, a regionalized version of the ESPY Awards. We unveiled this last year. We had our inaugural event. We've kind of positioned it as where we're convening the Boston, the New England sports community. We bring everybody together, athletes, executives, owners, those that are doing business in sports. We had the event last year at the House of Blues. It was hugely successful. We have it coming up again here in November 14th. And hopefully we're going to have some involvement with the Ad Club, actually, with this event. So November 14th, House of Blues. Tickets will be available soon. It's my shameless plug.